by the grace, by the grace of Jesus.
Nobody greater than me.
Search all over.
Search all over.
Couldn't find
nobody. I looked high and low. Still couldn't find nobody.
Nobody greater. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Come on, lift those hands for real in here. Come on. Nobody greater. Nobody greater, Jesus.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater. Nobody greater. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Now lift those hands, singers, and let's just give them the glory. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Couldn't find nobody.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater than you.
I dare you lift your hands and say that with us tonight. Come on. Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody greater than you.
Nobody like you, Jesus. Nobody greater than you.
God. Nobody greater.
Good morning, good morning, good morning to everybody. My name is Minister Michael Evans, and I'm your superintendent. And I want to welcome you to our virtual Sunday school experience where our pastor, Dr. Johnny M. Green, is our pastor. I want to also welcome all of our Facebook friends and our Zoom family. At this time, we will begin our morning devotional service.
Good morning. Our devotional service this morning is going to go as follows. Our song will be sung by Minister William Wade. Our morning scripture is going to be by Sister Ollie Tipton. And our morning prayer is by Brother Alex Brown. Minister Wade.
We are soldiers in the army. We have to fight. Although we have to cry, we have to hold up the bloodstained banner. We have to hold it up until we die. I said, we are soldiers in the army. We have to fight, although we got to cry. We got to hold up the bloodstained banner. We got to hold it up until we die. My mother was a soldier. She had her hands on the God's cry. But one day she got sick. She couldn't fight it anymore, but she stuck it out anyhow. All because that we are soldiers in the army. We got to fight, although we got to cry. We got to hold, we got to hold up bloodstained banner. We got to hold it up until we die. And our pastor was a soldier. He had his hands on his God's but proud. But one day he got sick. He couldn't fight it anymore, but he stuck it out anyhow. All because that we are soldiers in the army. We got to fight. Although we got to cry, we got to hold, we got to hold up the bloodstained banner. We got to hold it up until me die. Come on, church. And we are soldiers in the army. We got to fight. Although we got to cry, we got to hold up the bloodstained banner. We got to hold it up until we die. Thank you.
Amen.
Our scripture today will be coming from the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verse 16. It reads, above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. This is the word of God. Amen.
Father God, good morning. I'd like to thank you, Father God, for waking us up this morning. Thank you for a new day that has never been promised to anyone. I just thank you for allowing us to be able to breathe this morning, to walk all of our needs that we have. Father God, I'd like to ask you to pray for our pastor and his family this day. Father God, I'd like to ask you to pray for the Mount Nebo family in this pandemic. I ask you to pray for those who are sick, those who are right now who don't know where their needs might be met. But I know that you are God. And I ask you to bless those who may have lost someone this week, this month, this year. I ask you to bless them. And right now, I ask you to bless my mother-in-law who was COVID covered. And I ask you to bless her and her family as well. Dear Lord, I ask you right now to, more importantly, I ask you to bless those who don't know you this morning. And I ask that through some kind thought, word, or deed, that they may want to come to you. They may hear this message that's going to be given by Pastor this morning, or they might hear this Sunday school lesson, and they want to know to be closer to you. Dear Lord, I ask you more importantly, even it bless this country, our country right now. It seems like it's so split and so many things are going on. But I ask you that in God we trust, and we'll always do that. Father God, I ask you all these things in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Minister Athea, you are still muted. If you can unmute yourself.
Okay. All right. Are you hearing me now?
Yes, we are.
Okay. I'm sorry because I'm trying to get in. I'm sorry. Good morning, everyone. Coming to you with the icebreaker. This is a story that I'll be sharing with you this morning. There was a man once known as Dr. King. He had a wife, she was a teacher. They had two children. Their names were Jimmy and Jane. One was attending high school and the other was in college. Dr. King worked in a nearby clinic not too far away from his home. On returning home one day, he called his son, inviting him to come over to the clinic. You see, Dr. King always thought of his son being a doctor as he. Jimmy shows up at the clinic one day. He made a few rounds with Dr. King, watching as he attends to patients with cuts and bruises. One day he thought about the experience he had watching his father working in that clinic. And it gave him the desire to become like his father. So later, did his studies and went on to be a doctor. The point I want to make this morning is that there are fathers who would like to see their sons carrying on their legacy. So the question this morning I want to leave with you is, are you carrying on your Heavenly Father in Jesus Christ's legacy? And this is the outbreaking.
Good morning. Good morning. For those of you that are by telephone, my name is Deaconess Denise Evans, and I will be covering Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. And I will now ask our reader, Sister Shirley Reimer, please read the lesson for us.
Good morning, Mount Nebo. I'll be reading Luke 5, 1 through 5 in the NIV version, and it states as such. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him, listening to the word of God. He saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little from shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into deep water and let down the net for a catch. Simon answered, Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the net.
Amen. And as Luke chapter 5 opens, we see that Jesus is continuing his ministry. He's continuing his ministry from Nazareth after being driven out of Nazareth, after he had exorcised devils. He had healed Simon Peter's mother of a very high fever. The crowd got angry and they sought to kill him and drive him off a cliff. So Jesus has left Nazareth and now is at Lake Gennesaret, and he is continuing to preach. Now, Lake Gennesaret goes by a few other names. Does anyone know the other names that Lake Gennesaret goes by?
Galilee.
Yes, Galilee. That's one.
Tiberius.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Tiberius?
Oh. Yes. And there is another name that it goes by. Does anyone know?
Was it the lake?
Okay, it's the sea of Kinnereth, that's in the Old Testament. So as Jesus is by Lake Gennesaret, we can imagine he had to leave the synagogue because the crowds were getting so large that he'd had to go out in the open. And as Jesus is by Lake Gennesaret, the crowds are pressing. We have to imagine our mind's eye, the crowd, the lame, the infirm, the rich, the poor, the disenfranchised, the depressed, they are all there trying to hear a word from Jesus. As the crowd is pressing on Jesus, he finds himself being crowded. He is at Lake Gennesaret, which is around 600 feet below sea level. So therefore he is down and the crowd is up on a hill. He has a better vantage point so that he can preach to the crowd. So can you just imagine how Jesus is feeling, seeing this crowd around him, and he wants to get the word through. He wants to preach. So he is moving on, walking along the banks of Lake Gennesaret. And as it came to pass, Jesus is pressed upon to hear the word of God. The people are there trying to hear a word. So as Jesus is walking along, he sees two empty boats. He sees two empty boats. And I just think there's a significance here. He sees two empty boats, but he chooses a certain boat that has Simon in it. What is the significance of him choosing that boat? He could have very well chosen another boat to get into, but he chose the boat that Simon was in. Anyone?
Sister Shirley, I believe Jesus was on a mission to change Simon's heart. I think he wanted to save Simon. Simon was very sinful, and Jesus knew that, so he was on a mission to save Simon.
Okay, all right. I believe this. The significance of Jesus going to Simon's boat was because he had already had interaction with Simon by healing his mother-in-law at his home. He already had interaction with him, and Simon did not know this at the time. God was going to use him to be one of his greatest apostles and the leader. But Jesus being all-knowing, he already knew this. So Jesus is entering onto the boat. After he has witnessed the fishermen standing by the boat, washing out their nets, after they had been toiling all night and haven't caught any fish, he approaches them and gets on Simon's boat. He gets on Simon's boat and asks him to go out a little bit further. At this vantage point, Jesus is having a better view of the crowd, and the crowd can see him. And at this point, Jesus is sitting down to teach. This was the posture of the rabbis in the synagogue. They stood up to preach, to teach the word. They stood up amongst the people to read the word, but then they sat down to teach. This was the posture of the Jewish leadership at this time. So he told them to launch out into the deep. Why do you think he told them to launch out into the deep? What was the significance of that? Can anyone answer that for me? Amen.
Maybe he just wanted to have an intimate, private moment with Simon.
Amen. That's one of the reasons. But another reason is that, I'm sorry, someone else?
Yeah, I feel that Jesus was teaching Simon to come out of his comfort zone.
Yes.
And not always do what he's comfortable with doing, to reach out further.
Amen. Amen. So another thing that Jesus is here, he is teaching Simon, giving him personal tutorship because Simon Peter is going to be one of the greatest apostles. At the time, Simon didn't know this, of the calling that Jesus had on his life. What Jesus is teaching them is that when it was the time for them to go out into this, to the deep, Simon Peter was a little reluctant. He was doubtful because Jesus was asking them to go out into the deep in the daytime. You know, as fishermen, you do not fish in the daytime. You do not fish in the daytime. First of all, the fish usually come closer to the shore to feed. Amen. And then if you come in the daytime, the fish can see you. They say that we're dumb, but we're not stupid. We can see you with the nets trying to get us. So Jesus is telling them to go out a little bit deeper. Go out a little bit deeper and cast down your nets. And Simon, at first, he was doubtful. He was saying to himself, I imagine he was saying to himself, I'm a fisherman. I know all about this vocation. You're a carpenter. How would you know about my vocation? This is what I've been doing all of my life. All of my life I've been fishing. I know what it is to do, but nevertheless, he still obeyed Jesus and did what Jesus to say. He just still obeyed Jesus and did what Jesus said. And nevertheless, Simon said he would take Jesus at his word and do his bidding. He called him master, which recognized that he was in charge, that he was leadership, and he was following after Jesus. So what do you think here? Why do you think Simon Peter acted the way that he acted? Why do you think he was reluctant?
Because he had already been out all night fishing, and they didn't catch anything. So that was one of the reasons he was reluctant to do what Jesus had asked him to do.
And can you imagine that they had been out all night toiling, they're tired, they're hungry, they want to go home and come out the next day and start. And remember that during this time, fishing was the mode of occupation during this time by Lake Genesaret. The fishing was, their catch would be used to feed their family. So they went home without any fish, they can't feed their family. Also, the fishing was used to import and export all around the region. And so it would be lots of boats docked there, not just Simon and the other disciples that were with him at that time. There would be lots of boats docked there. So you can imagine how he felt at this time. Amen? Does anyone have any comments? Any more comments? Amen.
Also, Denise, they had already been out, like you said, but they had come in and they had cleaned their nets. Yes. And had already put their nets out to dry. So they had finished for the day. So that meant they would have to come back in and do this process all over again. So I think that was another reason they were reluctant.
Yes. Amen. And also they were a little doubtful, but Simon, having already had an interaction with Jesus, he knew that he was special. But then I believe when he let down the net, he realized, Master, I will do as you say, and I will let down the net. I just want to say that when God asks us to get out of our comfort zone and go a little bit further, a little bit deeper, sometimes we can be reluctant. But what we have to do is take God at his word. We have to get at the feet of the master and learn more of him. And we have to let our nets down. So the net would be representative of the word of God. So we want to go out there and fish. The fish would be representative of mankind. And then going out a little bit further into the deep will be going out into the world. And just like how COVID has us now on Zoom and out of the church, out of the four walls, we are still fishing. Matter of fact, we are fishing even more so now by going to Sunday school, by going to Sidewalk Saturdays. We are fishing even more. We are learning more about the word of God, and we are going further out to bring in disciples for Jesus Christ. We are going out to evangelize. So what we should continue to do, class, stay in the word of God, stay in Sunday school, and take God at his word. Do always trust him and do not doubt. And Jesus always will truly bring us out. I have come to the conclusion of my lesson, and I will now turn it over to Brother Kenny Jones, and he will take it a little bit further. Amen.
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 Thank you, Deaconess Evans, for that marvelous lesson and introduction. I'm going to ask, will Minister Steve Moody read Luke 5, 6 to 11 for me, please? Minister Moody?
Okay, yes, Luke 5, 6 to 11. And when they had this done, they increased the great multitude of fishes and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in their other ship, that they should come and help them. They came and filled both the ships so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he was astonished and all that were with him at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, "Fear not, from henceforth, thou shalt catch men." And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. The word of the Lord is blessed.
Amen. Amen. And this is reacting without hesitation, responding without hesitation. As you can see in verse 6, Peter and his fellow fishermen, they did exactly what Jesus said. In other words, that means that they listened and they followed to his commandment. Even though, as Deaconess Evan told us that they were reluctant, but they did it. And when they finally relinquished their powers and did exactly what Jesus told them to do, they were blessed because as you see, they said that they picked up a multitude of fish. I mean, they picked up so many that his net broke. He had to call his other fellow fishermen to come and help him to gather up the fish. And they gathered up so much that the Bible tells us that the boat started to sink. So this tells us can you just imagine if we would just listen, if we listen to what the word of God tells us every day when we say our prayers or when we read our word, that we still should be blessings upon blessings. And this is what happened. He was so blessed that he blessed his fellow fishermen, because when they all gathered the fish in, the boat almost nearly sank. And then after that, Simon did something that he did, because he listened to what the word said, which we know that Jesus is the word. So he obeyed what the word had told him. Even through his reluctancy, he still obeyed it. And then after, when he seen the blessing that came upon him and his fellow fishermen, he did something. He dropped to his knees, which means he repented. He said, look what he said in verse 8. He said he was astonished and he fell to his knees and told the Lord that he was a sinful man. See, so sooner or later, no matter what situation we may be in, sooner or later, the Bible said that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord. And then what Peter did, what Simon Peter did, he fell to his knees. He's like, Master, and I like how Luke was the only gospel writer of the four that used the word master in calling out Jesus. He was the only writer that used that phrase master, which also caught my attention. And Ken, like I said, Ken, just imagine that we did the same thing as Peter did. And when we say our prayers at night, or when we read our word in the morning, that we listen to what the Lord tells us, and that if we listen to exactly and follow him without hesitancy, without doubt, without conviction, you know, with conviction, that we just come to him and let him know what's going on and give up ourselves and when we fall short. Because the Bible said we all shall fall short to the glory of God. So that means that we have to repent every day, not just when we think we did something wrong. And then I like that, because when he fell to his knees, it just reminded me of that song that says, I came to Jesus just as I was, weary, wounded, and stained. But I found in him a resting place, and he made me glad. Imagine, just imagine that. I mean, and we gotta also understand that Peter, he listened to Jesus when Jesus was teaching the multitude. So that means that that word must have also got into him. That Jesus was teaching the multitude. So he had another reason why to understand who this man was that he called master. No. See, they couldn't see the thing about it, that they couldn't fathom, you know, looking at the amount of fish that they had collected. And just like us, when pastor preaches, we can't fathom what we would do if we listen to his teachings and gather with him and what Reverend Baker teaches at on Wednesday night Bible study. Imagine we stayed in Bible study, go to Sunday school, study our word. Our blessing shouldn't be so sporadic, but it should be every day. We should have something to thank God about and to be happy about and to gather in. Because the word tells, because remember, the word tells us that he said that, number one, he'll never leave us nor forsake us. Number two, he said he should supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. So he's, so these are already promises that he promised us. But sometimes through our hesitancy, we want to know why things happen so slowly, why things don't happen as quickly as it should, that we think they should be. And we should look at this lesson, look at Peter and his response and the response of his fellow fishermen to how we should deal with our walk and our relationship with Christ. That we should have that same tenacity, that, you know, that non-hesitancy. But even as Christians, some of us still hesitate. We still hesitate if we're being honest with ourselves. You know, some of us still kind of on the border, on the fence, as some people would say. So we have to really look at this. Because it just remind me of what Dr. J. Vernon McGee, who was a great Presbyterian preacher. And this is what he says. He says that every pulpit is a fishing boat, a place to give out the word of God with the attempt to catch fish. As believers, we are also ambassadors and evangelists, you know, and we are a channel to the blessings to share with others. Without God, with what God has already blessed us with and given us to graciously give to others. I mean, that we are supposed to be a blessing to others, and we're supposed to share His word. And not for us to keep it within us, but we're supposed to share it as ambassadors. We're supposed to share it as evangelists. You know, because we are the channel to a dying world as believers. That is our calling. Don't matter what your title in church or anything, but as a believer, you are a believer, you are a follower of Christ. And that is that is our destiny. And you see at the end, they said that they didn't even celebrate all the fish they took in. The last verse said that they left everything and followed him. They left all. They didn't, you know, if somebody caught that much fish, you know, you'd be telling everybody what you did. But they didn't do that. They just left it. They dropped everything, family, everything, and they followed him. But he said, I'm gonna make y'all fishers of men, and that's what we are supposed to be. We're supposed to be fishers men and women. And with this, I just thank y'all. I just hope y'all got something out of this lesson today, as we have, as teachers. We just want to bless y'all and say amen.
And here's what I want you to understand.
This time we will hear from our pastor.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, and praise the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will be glad in it. This has been a wonderful Sunday school, all of the dialogue, all of the exposition. I was really blessed by the icebreaker from Minister Althea, and Sister Denise Evans, your commentary was just spot on this morning. And I don't know why it took so long for us to get you on the front line in Sunday school and teaching. Man, you are somebody's Sunday school teacher. I would have liked to have had you as a Sunday school teacher growing up. But I want to thank everybody for your participation this morning. This is just wonderful. This is beautiful to see how collaboratively we have come together, and how you all have worked so hard to bring such a five-star Sunday school presentation to our membership as we are virtually staying together as a church family. Then I want to thank our leaders, Minister Evans and Sister Cooper and Reverend Baker, for the way that the Sunday school meets each week. And it's a testament to the leadership. It's a testament to the leadership of the church's entirety, deacons, our trustees, and just our program is tight. And I'm just thankful for all that the Lord has done, is doing, and will do. Just continue to give your best to the Lord. Because the song says, if when you give the best of your service, telling the world that the Savior has come, be not dismayed when men won't receive you. He'll understand and say, well done. And I believe the Lord is saying right now, Reverend Sandra Baker, well done to the Sunday school. I implore you to join us at 9:30 for our worship this morning. I'm going to be preaching a message entitled Sharing Our Faith with Others. It's going to fall right in sync with the Sunday school lesson this morning. And I invite you to join us. God bless you. God keep you is my prayer. Carry on.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Green, for those words. Good morning, Mount Nebo. My name is Minister Maya Clark, and this morning I will be bringing forth the life application. I think that it has been very clear on this morning what question remains. Thank you, Deaconess Evans and Brother Kenny for the amazing lesson. I believe that the lesson really brought us to one question, and that question is, are you listening or are you being obedient in this season to God's will and to God's way in your life? After listening to the lesson today, the focus point of our life application is very simple. Being a follower of Christ, do you find yourself willing to put yourself out there to take a chance on God's word, or do you find yourself at times doubting yourself or even doubting God? Take a minute to ask yourself, are you being obedient to God's will and his way, or are you being doubtful? We all know that within life, we do find ourselves being doubtful. And even though God has done so many things in our past seasons, we do find ourselves being a little or having minimal doubt. Simon was obedient regardless of his minimal doubt of thinking he wasn't going to catch anything. It was his obedience that truly made all of the difference. So as the lesson has already been explained, Simon was told to go out again after he had worked and toiled all night to go and catch more fish. Simon's main response was, you know, Master, I'm just going to obey you at your word because I know you've done it before, but because I'm tired, and even though we find ourselves being so tired day after day, you know, working, doing whatever we're doing, we do find ourselves becoming so tired, and when we're faced with trials and tribulations, we know that God has saved us before. We know that God has brought us out before, but oftentimes we still have that minimal doubt that is saying, you know what, God, we're going to obey you because we know who you are. But you know what? At this time, I'm having a little bit of uncertainty, and that is truly okay. But the identification that I believe that was taken from this lesson for myself, and I hope that each and every one of you can take, is the initial response that Simon responded as. His initial response was, Master, you are who you say you are. And because of that, I am going to be obedient to your will and to your way. And because of that, when he went out, he was able to catch an overflow. He was able to receive an abundance of blessings. So like we always say, God will give us blessings that we won't even have room enough to receive. And that is exactly what happened with Simon. And even though, like it has been identified, even though Simon's mother-in-law was healed by Jesus, you always need that personal relationship. You always need that personal thing to identify something that's big for you. And this is what it was for Simon. And so let's then identify the second response from Simon. And his second response was, Lord, I am a sinful man. He identifies God from coming from identifying Jesus as master based off of him obeying his master's word. He then identifies Jesus as his Lord and Savior. And I think that that is so imperative to pay attention here, even within our own lives. Oftentimes we obey God because that is what we know we should do. But then identifying God as our Lord and Savior, being Lord of all, being Lord of everything, being Lord of all creation, to know without a shadow of a doubt that this is who he is and who he has continued to be in your own life, it allows your obedience to never waver, even in the midst of it wavering. So even in your unbelief, you continue to believe because of the Lord being Lord of all. And so finally, I want you to challenge yourself to look at yourself like Simon did. I spoke about this earlier in the week, if you follow our millennials page, that oftentimes we need to focus on it not being about everybody else and everybody else doing something to us, but sometimes we need to identify who we are as a person, who we fall short to be at times. And Simon had fallen short for a little while because he knew that he was tired. He knew he was worn out. He knew that him and his flock has toiled all night. But despite of him being tired, he still set forth and said, you know what, this is what I'm going to do. So I believe that the life application is to be obedient. So identify that for yourself today. Are you being obedient? And remember, and always remember, that obedience is truly better than sacrifice. And when you are obedient, God brings you to a place of overflow. He brings you to a place of an abundance, and that alone is a blessing. So again, I am Minister Clark, and this is the Life Application. God bless you all.
Amen, amen. We praise God for our superintendents, Evans and Cooper, and of course to our pastor and to the fine Christian educators of the Mount Nebo Church. What an awesome lesson we've experienced on this morning. And as it is the custom of the Mount Nebo Church, we believe after hearing such a powerful teaching that we would extend to you the opportunity to become a part of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. On this morning, the word has gone forth, and our topic this morning was called to follow. And so God ministered unto Peter because there was a calling on his life to follow him. And so this morning, this lesson has been given, and there's some man, some woman, some boy, some girl that after listening to this lesson, God is knocking on the heart and he's asking you, will you follow me? Will you follow me? You may be hesitant. You may be afraid. You're wondering, can I follow him with my past? Can I follow him with all of my hangups? Can I follow him when I know I'm not going to be perfect? Let me assure you, your answer can be yes. Because even in your weaknesses, the word of God says that's when he makes you strong. No one on this Zoom call will tell you we're perfect. We will tell you we serve a perfect God. We will tell you that even in our weaknesses, he will make us strong. So on this morning, will you be obedient? On this morning, will you choose to launch out in the deep? Will you choose to say, I need God to bring me into his purpose for my life? No matter what you're doing, if you don't have Christ in your life, you are not doing it in a great way, in a way of overflow. God says that he has come that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Why should you just survive when God wants you to thrive? Why would you stay close to the shore when God wants you to go deep? So on this morning, if you're listening, we invite you, don't hesitate any longer, but choose him. Will you join the psalmist when they said, I've decided to follow Jesus. I've decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. If that is your cry this morning, we invite you, if you're watching on Facebook, please go to the description box. You'll find a link that will take you to our website. On the website, you'll find a form that you can fill out to become a member. And if you don't want to go through that procedure, just put it in the chat box. We have members who are watching. We have members who will call you and welcome you in, because here at the Mount Nebo Church, we believe that God is doing greater. We believe to expect greater. And the only way you can expect greater, you have to be hooked up with the right source. And Jesus Christ is the answer for the world today. God bless you is my prayer in the hands of our superintendent.
Amen. Amen, amen. Now, this part of our virtue service is for giving. And if you believe in your heart of heart that God has touched you with this virtue Sunday school word, that he has done something to you, has blessed something, has given you a blessing, then please, we encourage you to return that blessing back onto us. We encourage you to give and support this ministry as we teach the word of God, as we teach the unadulterated word of God. We have several ways of giving. We can give by Giveify. You go to your Giveify app, you tap give, and you're Giveified. And then there's another way we have to give. It's called Zelle. And you go to that, and you go to mtneboh@aol.com. and give through Zelle. And then we have another way of giving. You can call our trustee, Janice House, and you can give by Square. You can call her up and give by Square. If you need her numbers on the church page. And then you can send, you can mail your gift into us. You can mail your gift into us at Mount Nebo Baptist Church, 1883 Adam Clayton Powell Drive, New York. Please, we encourage you to support this ministry, for we are doing the will and purpose of God. Amen. Now I turn this part of our service over to our assistant superintendent, Dolores Cooper.
Good morning, everyone. At this time, we will have our daily Bible readings for the week of January 11th through the 17th. On Monday, our scripture, Isaiah chapter 57, verses 14 through 21, peace and healing will come. On Tuesday, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 18 through 25, healed by Christ's wounds. Wednesday, Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28, Canaanite daughter healed by mother's faith. Thursday, James chapter 5, verses 13 through 16, anoint sick with oil and prayer. Friday, Mark chapter 5, verses 21 through 34, woman healed by her faith. Saturday, Mark chapter 2, verses 13 through 17, the sick need a physician. And Sunday, Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, Jesus heals and forgives the paralytic. Our scripture readings for next week.
Amen, amen. Thank you, Superintendent Dolores Cooper. Now we'll have our weekly announcements and our monthly announcements starting Monday. That is tomorrow, January 11th. Our annual church budget meeting will be held via Zoom at 7 p.m. And immediately following that, we will have our leadership meeting. We'll be following exactly after that at 8 p.m. So we encourage you, please sign in, get on, and be involved. And we just need you to be involved, all of our leaders, and also. And now on Wednesday, January 13th, we will continue in our Bible enrichment at 6:45 via Facebook Live. Please join in and be encouraged, be enriched in the word of God, where our very own Reverend Sandra Baker, our Director of Christian Education, will be the facilitator. Thank you. Please join in. And then next Sunday, on January 17th at 9:30 a.m., our worship service will be held. We will have our installation of office for 2021. We will be having our installation of offices at 2021 on January 17th on our 9:30 worship service. We encourage you, please stay and be involved in that too. On Thursday, the 21st, January 21st at 7 p.m., as part of our social media outreach effort, the ministers of Mount Nebo will be hosting a roundtable discussion on Facebook Live. Share the news with your friends and neighbors to join us. More information can be found on the Mount Nebo Baptist Church homepage, but we encourage you on the 21st, be a part of that too. We are doing great ministry at Mount Nebo Baptist Church. Don't miss out on anything, because this is the will and purpose that God has for us. On Sunday, January 31st, we will have our first 2021 Fantastic Sunday at 9:30 a.m., our worship service, where our pastor will be preaching, but we encourage you to invite someone, invite a friend, invite a family member, host a party on Facebook, host a party. We invite you to share and be involved on Fantastic Sunday. That's our way of outreaching. I always like to just say, it is just fantastic that we're having Fantastic on Sunday. So that's, we encourage you to do that on January 31st. And then check our homepage for any further information. And please be involved. Remember, our hotline is still up. We had asked you to call for all kinds of resources. If you need prayer, if you need someone to talk to, if you need some information where we can share with you that can assist you in your day-to-day life and ups and downs, we are here for you. Our hotline is open from Monday through Saturday, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Please, it is there for you, so use it if you need it. And then we are praying for all of the bereaved families, all of the families that are going through what they're going through right now. We have lost so much, but guess what? Weeping will endure for a night, joy will come in the morning. We are praying for our sister, Annette Williams. She has suffered the loss of her nephew. And then we are praying for Sister Ruth Ann and her Ruth Ham, as we just celebrated our homegoing service. So we are praying for her family. We are lifting her family up during this bereavement time. Please continue to pray. And then we are praying also for Sister Rayanne Bessie Lou. We all know us, most of us on the line know Rayanne Bessie Lou, and we know that she's very dear to heart. She has lost a sister. So we ask that you keep her in prayer, keep her family in prayer, as she is going through what most of us have gone through or going through too. And then Sister Minnie Blackman has lost her brother. We ask you continue to pray for her and lift her up during her bereavement time. Remember all those who we have lost, our loved ones, we'd ask during this time, will you continue to pray? Prayer will fix it every time. We know that prayer still works. And as we know that prayer still works, we ask you that you continue to lift those up on that on our prayer list. Brother Thomas Gibson and Brother James Baxter and all those that are going through that needs prayer. We ask you to pray for the family of Kimberly LaPrince, for her family has come down with the COVID-19 and she is asking us that we will lift her family up in prayer. And we know that God hears our prayer and he will answer. He will do what he said he will do. So we're asking that you lift all of those families up in prayer and our bereaved families, of course, also. Thank you so much for hearing these messages and keeping them to heart. At this time, as we come to the close of our virtual Sunday school service, we would ask that Sister Aaron Valentine. Sister Aaron Valentine, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Good morning.
Okay, Sister Alan, Sister Valentine, we would ask that you will follow, repeat after me. Let the words of my mouth.
Let the words of my mouth.
And the meditation of my heart.
And the meditation of my heart.
Be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
Be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, everybody, for this virtual worship service. We had an awesome time. The teachers were awesome. Everybody was great. Maya, it was good to see you break the ice and come out. You did a great job. Kenny, you did a great job. Of course, Sister Deaconess Evans, you did a great job. All of our leaders, all of our devotionists, we just enjoy you so much. Amen. Now, we encourage you to stay tuned for our pastor that will be coming up in our virtual worship service at 9:30 a.m. Please don't miss it. He's an awesome preacher and a teacher.